In this video, we introduce the Bainbridge mass spectrometer, which is a type of magnetic sector analyzer for doing mass spectrometry. A magnetic sector analyzer allows us to find the mass, or at least the mass to charge ratio, of ionized atoms and molecules by taking advantage of the fact that the curvature of a charged particle in a magnetic field depends on its mass. So if we look at this box on the left, we've vaporized a sample and pumped the gas into this chamber, and that's not shown in the diagram. And then we need to ionize the gas somehow, and electron bombardment, also known as electron ionization, is a fairly popular way to do this. We hit the gas atoms with energetic electrons, and the collisions will sometimes knock an electron off the atoms or molecules we want to study, leaving these particles positively charged. Note that this ionization process almost always produces a single ionization, so the resulting charge on the ionized particle is plus QE, the elementary charge. And if you recall, that's 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. Occasionally, we get double ionizations, resulting in a charge of twice the elementary charge. Next, we need a way to coax these particles out of the ionization chamber and get them to the accelerating potential. So we use an ion repeller for this. And that's just a positively charged plate that pushes the ions out of the ionization chamber past the positive plate of the accelerating potential. And once the positive ions get beyond that plate, they're accelerated from some positive voltage down to zero through the potential difference across these plates. As the ions accelerate through the potential difference, they pass through one or more additional slits in order to narrow the beam. Ions crashing into the plates will pick up an electron and be neutralized, and those will eventually be pumped out of the spectrometer by the vacuum pumps that keep the interior evacuated. Finally, the ions leave the ground plate, and we have a narrow beam of high-velocity ions headed into the next stage. At the next stage, we have a Wien filter, also called a speed or velocity selector, consisting of crossed electric and magnetic fields. The purpose of the Wien filter is to create a very narrow band of velocities in the beam, and this improves the resolution of the spectrometer, reducing the error bars on mass-to-charge calculations. This is necessary because, although all the particles have been accelerated through the same potential difference, the particles emerge with a distribution of speeds from the ionizing chamber just due to the random motion in the gas. If we zoom in on the Wien filter here, it has a downward electric field and an inward magnetic field. The downward electric field exerts a downward force on the positive particle. Then, using the right-hand rule for the magnetic force on a particle in this beam, I point my fingers in the direction of the velocity and sweep out to the direction of the magnetic field. The direction of my thumb is the direction of magnetic force, and that's upward. Since the magnetic force is speed dependent, we should be able to find one special speed for which the force is balanced. I plug in the magnitude of the magnetic force, that's QVB, because the motion is perpendicular to the magnetic field. And then the electric force, that's QE. So it doesn't matter what Q is. I find that the special speed that's undeflected by these fields is E over B. So the particles moving at that special speed are undeflected. Particles moving at a significantly different speed will crash into the plates, picking up an electron and being neutralized and eventually evacuated from the interior of the device. Next, our beam of high-velocity positive ions with a very narrow range of speeds enters the analyzer region in which we see an outward-pointing magnetic field. And I'll call that magnetic field BA for analyzer. While I'm at it, the one in the Wien filter will be called BW. As the beam first enters the analyzer region, it's moving perfectly to the right. Using the right-hand rule once again, we find that the magnetic force is downward. This magnetic force can't do any work on the moving particles because it's perpendicular to the velocity, but it does turn the velocity vector. So the speed is going to stay the same, and our velocity vector is going to rotate clockwise. A little further along, my velocity is tilted like this. I use the right-hand rule once again, and I find my perpendicular magnetic force pointing something like this. So this magnetic force, it just keeps pointing at the center of curvature, and we have uniform circular motion for the particles in the beam. Writing down Newton's second law, F net equals ma for one of these particles. There's only one force acting on them, and it's the magnetic force. So that's QVB, again, because the velocity is already perpendicular to the magnetic field. And that's equal to m times the centripetal acceleration, which is v squared over r. Again, I should call that BA for the analyzer region. Now we can cancel one factor of v and solve for the mass to charge ratio. So I divide both sides by q, I multiply by r and divide by v. And I get a mass to charge ratio of r BA over V. It'll also be useful to think about the radius of curvature at times. So if I solve this for R instead, I get MV over QB. Finally, the particles arrive at the detector. But what are we detecting here? Remember, this is a stream of positively charged ions. So what we're detecting at the detector is a current. So in this experiment, I've measured the mass-to-charge ratio for one particular type of atom or molecule in the sample. How do we find all the other atoms and molecules in the sample? You might say to yourself, if we're dealing with a heavier atom, it will emerge moving slower from the accelerating potential, and therefore get screened off by the speed selector. Furthermore, two isotopes making it through the speed selector might have masses that are very nearly the same, but maybe the lighter one is detected while the heavier one moves with a larger radius of curvature and misses the detector. Looking at our radius formula, I can see a larger mass would mean a bigger radius of curvature, and our heavier particle would miss the detector. The resolution to these questions is that we have control over the knobs in this experiment. Depending on the design of the mass spectrometer, we might be able to vary the accelerating potential, the speed selector, and the magnetic field in the analyzer region. For example, I can imagine gradually increasing the magnetic field in the analyzer region and detecting that slightly heavier isotope as it sweeps upward in magnetic field strength, because a larger magnetic field would shrink that radius of curvature and get that particular isotope to hit the detector. So in practice, a mass spectrometer will sweep through a wide range of settings to detect particles with many different masses, or at least their mass-to-charge ratios. We can then display the contents of the sample in a mass spectrum, showing the relative abundance of each particle as a function of the mass-to-charge ratio. Note that a spectrum may contain one line for a singly ionized atom and another for its doubly ionized counterpart. We can then recognize the relationship between these two lines and infer we are probably looking at two ionizations of the same atom. In addition, when we're studying molecules, the molecules can be fragmented in the ionization process. Thus, a single molecule can produce many lines corresponding to the masses of all the fragments. This is actually useful because it gives us a characteristic fingerprint for identifying the molecule. And in fact, for the mass spectrum of toluene shown down here in the corner, that's exactly what we're looking at. We're looking at the masses of a bunch of different fragments of the toluene molecule. And this produces a characteristic toluene signature. Let's wrap things up with an example. We're told that while we're analyzing a sample with a mass spectrometer, we detect a current at the following specifications. Again, that means a beam of ions is hitting the detector. We're told for the Wien filter that there's a plate separation of 1 centimeter, that is between the charge plates that exert the electric field. We have a voltage of 80 volts across those plates. And we have a magnetic field magnitude of BW equals 0.126 tesla. In the analyzer region, we have a diameter from the entry point into the analyzer all the way down to the detector. Again, this is a semicircle of 40 centimeters, and that means the radius of curvature is 20 centimeters for any beam that's going to be detected. And we have a magnetic field in the analyzer region of BA is 0.0396 tesla. We're asked to compute the mass-to-charge ratio of the particle, so let's get that done first. And quoting our formula for the mass-to-charge ratio, I need the radius of curvature, I need the magnetic field in the analyzer region, and I need the particle speed. Well, I've still got to figure out the particle speed, and that's nailed down very precisely by the Wien filter. That's given by the electric field over the magnetic field in that velocity selector. Now remember, electric field can be measured in volts per meter. I just take the voltage and divide by the separation between the plates. So that's a capital V over dBW. That's 80 volts over 0.01 meters for the plate separation, 0.126 tesla for the magnetic field strength. And I get 6.349 times 10 to the fourth meters per second. Now it looks like I can proceed with the mass to charge ratio. I have a radius of curvature of 20 centimeters or 0.2 meters, a magnetic field strength of 0.0396 tesla in the analyzer region, and a particle speed of 6.349 times 10 to the fourth meters per second. This leaves me with a mass to charge ratio of 1.247 times 10 to the negative 7, and that would be measured in kilograms per coulomb. Now we're told to convert the mass to atomic mass units, and what I'm going to do here is actually convert the mass to charge ratio. So we get the kind of numbers that would ordinarily be output from one of these machines. I want to phrase the mass in terms of atomic mass units. And I'm going to change my charge in terms of the elementary charge. And when I run the numbers on this, I get 12.02 atomic mass units per elementary charge. So that 12.02 is more like the printout of a mass spectrometer would actually tell you. That's the actual number. Now I'm going to take 12.02 atomic mass units per elementary charge and multiply it by the charge on this particle. We're told to assume the particle has been singly ionized, and that means its charge is one elementary charge. I cancel those out. And I find that the mass of my particle is 12.02 atomic mass units. Finally, we're asked to refer to a periodic table to determine the likely identity of the particle. So let's bring in a periodic table. And the number at the top of each of these boxes tells you the average atomic mass of these different elements, averaging over all their different isotopes. So we can just get a ballpark out of this. I notice immediately that carbon is a hopeful candidate. And when I zoom in on it, I see this average atomic mass of 12.0107. So that's the average of all the different isotopes and their relative abundances for carbon. And some of them are heavier than carbon-12. So we do a little bit of Googling if necessary, and we find out that the mass of a carbon-12 is exactly 12 atomic mass units. And the reason why we get such a round answer is that the atomic mass unit is defined in terms of carbon itself. Maybe it would be nice to get a percent error on this, and it's about 0.2% off. So we're pretty confident the ions that we're looking at here are carbon-12 ions. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.